Genesis and Creation in the Wisdom Literature, Part 2, Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. We've been going through the Genesis account of origins and its reverberations in the Old Testament. A couple of books edited by Gerald Klingbeil, one more scholarly, one more popular. And there are the covers. We are now in Chapter 7, Part 2. Well, if you want to be technical, I suppose you could say part 2 and 3. We'll be going through both Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. The chapter is entitled Genesis and Creation in the Wisdom Literature. In the larger book, it's written by Ángel Rodríguez, who is part of the Biblical Research Institute in Silver Spring, Maryland. And we'll first cover creation in Proverbs. Creation motifs in the book of Proverbs are actually fairly easy to find when you start reading. In Proverbs, we find a significant number of texts addressing aspects of creation theology, clearly indicating that the writers knew about the creation account of Genesis 1 and 2. The new element carefully developed in the book is that God created through wisdom. This is stated very early in the book. The Lord, by wisdom, founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. Humanity and marriage. Rodríguez is trying to show, and I think does well, that God created marriage. God is the Ose, the maker or creator of humans. In Proverbs 17:5, who according to Proverbs 20:27 are also animated by the God-given spirit, literally the breath of life. Or Nesama. I guess it's actually Nesama. In this passage, the term used for humans is Adam, and together with Nesama, provides a useful linguistic match to Genesis 2:7. Humans are male and female, united by God in a marriage relationship. He who finds a wife finds a good thing. That's that word tov that we saw, and God saw that it was good. And obtains favor from the Lord. In this case, tov is used in conjunction with the verb to find, and it probably means to find one's fortune. That is to say, to find a person of great value. Its meaning is further clarified by the phrase obtain favor, or rason, from the Lord, which means that the husband has been blessed by the Lord. The implication of the text is that the husband has little to do with acquiring such a prize. She is a gift from God. This idea goes back to Genesis 2:22-24, where God brings Eve to Adam and blesses both of them. The concept of marriage found in Proverbs is the one established in Genesis. A man and a woman are united in the presence of God. He blesses them, and a partnership is instituted among the three of them at that moment. The couple makes a covenant with and before the Lord. And the two of them establish a relationship of mutual loving friendship. Wisdom and creation. The phrase Eitz Chaim, or tree of life, is employed outside Genesis only in four passages in Proverbs. Even though it is used in three of these, Proverbs 11:30, 13:12, and 15:4, in a metaphorical sense, the mere fact that the presence of this motif seems to provide a link to the important story of origins found in Genesis 1 through 3. Concerning the use of the same phrase in Proverbs 3:18, it has been argued that here we have a non-metaphorical use of it referring back to Genesis. The passage reads, "She," that is wisdom, "is a tree of life," or Eitz Chaim, "to those who take hold of her, and happy are all those who hold her fast." The text gives the impression that even here the phrase is being used metaphorically to refer to the life-giving nature of wisdom. The allusion to the Garden of Eden is argued by those who are arguing it, by indicating that in the context we find terminology that is common to both. For instance, in Proverbs 3:13, the noun man, or literally Adam, or Adam, is used twice. This double use of the term is unique in the Hebrew Bible. The argument is that the verse obviously applies to any individual in general, but designating him by Adam rather than one of its alternatives, for example, Ish, is dictated by desire to emphasize an allusion to Ha'adam of the Garden of Eden story. Also, Proverbs 3:19-20 resembles 8:22-31, where the role of wisdom in creation is discussed, and where we also find a connection with Genesis 4:4-10. The most important argument, according to this interpretation, is based on the connection between Proverbs 3:17-18. In verse 17, we read about the ways and paths of wisdom that are pleasant and peaceful, and verse 18 begins with the tree of life. The suggestion is made that combining the words of the two verses yields a translation, her ways are the ways of or toward the tree of life. It is then concluded that Proverbs 3:18 signals us that the way back to the tree of life is through wisdom. Now, is that metaphorical or is that literal? In our opinion, that's Rodriguez, this reading of verse 17 and 18 is hardly defensible, but the close connection between the way and the tree of life found in both Proverbs and Genesis is significant and supports the argument that we find here at least an allusion to Genesis 2 and 3. I will also suggest that even if we conclude that the phrase tree of life is used metaphorically, the allusion to Genesis still stands. The text assumes that there was a tree of life and that literal access to it in the garden is no longer possible. The text then proceeds to teach that we can again have access to the tree of life through divine wisdom. Wisdom and cosmology. Proverbs, in a unique way, develops the role of wisdom in the creation of the world. While this emphasis on wisdom is not in Genesis, it is not presented here as an alternative to the Genesis account. On the contrary, we will argue that it enriches that account by taking us into the thoughts of the Creator. The key passage on the topic of creation is Proverbs 8:22-31, which is a part of a wisdom poem in the form of speech, in which wisdom is personified and invites humans to listen to her. The authority of her call to listen is based on her knowledge, her value for human existence, and her close relationship with the Creator. She can be a reliable guide for humans. We will concentrate our comments on verses 22-31 and examine some of their central ideas. This passage is not properly speaking about creation, but about wisdom. But in the process, something very important is said about creation. With respect to creation itself, the passage could be divided into two sections. One of them is about the pre-creation conditions, and the other about creation itself. Although the main interest of the passage is not to describe creation along the lines of the Genesis creation account, a connection with Genesis is undeniable. Proverbs is not a creation account, but a highly poetic description of creation. The pre-creation state. The pre-creation state is depicted through negatives. This is done in Proverbs 8:24-26 by using a particle of negation, ein, with the preposition b, when, attached to it, when there were no, so ba'ein, in verse 24, as well as an adverb of time, terem, with the prefixed preposition b, before, so as b'terem. Verse 25a, notice the preposition lipne, or before, and another preposition ad, also accompanied by a negative, while he had not yet made, ad lo asa, until he had not made, or before he had made, is a better English parallel. And I'm just going to read the passage, the verses chapter 8, verse 22, the Lord possessed me in the beginning of his way, before his works of old. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning or ever the earth was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills, I was brought forth. Whilst as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandment, when he appointed the fountains of the earth, there I was by him as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. Rejoicing in the habitable part of his earth, and my delights were with the sons of men. A partial description of the pre-creation condition of some elements of the earth is also found in Genesis 2, 5, and 6, where similar terminology is employed. No shrub of the field was yet, that's terem. No plant of the field had yet, terem. There was no man, ain. In the case of Genesis 1, there is no description of the pre-creation state of the cosmos. Before cosmic creation, there was only God, and this by itself indicates creatio ex nihilo. According to Proverbs, before creation, there was no depths, or tehomot, which sounds a lot like the tehom, you may remember darkness upon the face of the deep. No springs, my ayin, sources of water, abounding in water, and no mountains, harim, or hills, Gebaot. God had not yet made the earth, Eretz, the fields, Chutzot, and the first dust, or Aprot, of the world. In other words, the earth as we know it, with water, mountains, hills, and dust, had not yet been created. According to Genesis, God created the earth, Eretz, the depths, afar, and the deep, Tehom, which is associated with the springs, my enoth of water, which are actually from Genesis 7:11, which is the flood story. Ma enoth Tehom, the fountains of the deep. It's actually Einoth. The mountains and the hills are not mentioned in Genesis 1, but since they are part of the earth as we know it, they are included in the list of what was not there before creation. Creation itself, the wisdom poem moves from pre-creation to creation itself at the moment when God was creating. We're given only a few examples of what he created, but they are framed by reference to the heavens, or Shemayim, at the beginning of the list, and to the earth, or Eretz, at the end. This takes us back to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens, Shemayim, and the earth, Eretz. And also in Genesis 2, to finish off the story. In between these two, Proverbs emphasizes the skies and water. God is described in the passage as the architect who is building the cosmos and the earth. He established, or kun, the heavens. He inscribed, hakak, a circle on the face of the deep. He made firm the skies, amitz, and the skies being shahak, above. Fixed, azaz, to show oneself strong, the springs of the deep, and set boundaries, hok, limits or regulations to the sea. And he marked out, hakak, to inscribe, decree. You'll notice that these two are cognate. The foundations, Mossad, of the earth. The language describes the work of a person who is constructing nothing less than the cosmos. The central purpose of the passage, the main interest of the passage, is not on the creation of the cosmos, but on the significance of wisdom. The brief discussion of the pre-creation period has the purpose of establishing that divine wisdom pre-existed, while the discussion about the divine acts of creation reveals that during creation she was already with him. The Lord possessed me, Hanani, at the beginning, of his way, as in Bereshit, you may remember, Bereshit bara. Darko, before his works of old, me'ads, from of old. From everlasting I was established, nisakti. When there were no depths, I was brought forth, chil, to be in labor. Verse 24, also in verse 25. The language is used as highly figurative and is basically taken from the experience of human reproduction. Scholars are divided with respect to the meaning of the word kana in Proverbs 8:22. It is generally recognized that its basic meaning is to acquire, from which other derived uses are possible: to possess, to buy, to create, and to beget. What is strongly debated is whether the verb also means to create. It has been suggested that this usage may be implied in only two passages, which we went over in the rest of Genesis. Genesis 14:19 and Genesis 14:22 is a maker of heaven and earth, kana, the possessor of heaven and earth. In the context of wisdom, the main possibilities are to acquire, to possess, and to beget. This means that the determining factor would have to be the immediate context. The context clearly supports the idea of begetting. Wisdom herself unambiguously states that she came into being through birth, I was brought forth, indicating that at some point she was born. The Hebrew verb hil used here is a comprehensive term for everything from the initial contractions to the birth itself. It is therefore better to interpret the verb kana as referring to the moment of conception. The moment when the action of the verb took place is identified as at the beginning, using the same Hebrew term employed in Genesis 1:1, reshit. At the beginning of his way is clarified as before his works of old. When God began his work of creation, wisdom was already with him. He had already conceived her. In the next verse, the existence of wisdom is apparently pushed back into eternity. From everlasting, I was established. Me olam. Olam is commonly used as in terms of forever. The new verb nisakti, established me, is also a difficult verb. The Masoretic text vocalization indicates that it is the nifal form of nasak, to pour out, a libation offering. But this translation does not fit the context. In what sense was wisdom poured out? Where was it poured if nothing else had been created? There are two other possible readings of the verb. The first is consider nasak to be a biform of the verb nun samik kaf, nasak tu, meaning to be woven or to be formed. This biform is used in Isaiah 25:7. The veil noun maseka, which is from the same verb, designates a woven covering from the verb nasak to, which is stretched, nasak, to be woven, shaped over all nations. The second possibility is that the verb nisakti is from the verb sakak too, which means to weave or shape, and then in nifal formation, which is passive, to be made into shape or manufactured. In this case, it would be necessary to repoint the Masoretic text, which means leaving the consonants alone but changing the vowels. The vowels were not originally written. And so it is legal, although what it means is you're going against the Jewish tradition of reading it. And so instead of Nisakti, you would have to read Nisakoti, which is a minor modification. The consonant text remains the same. The meaning of the two verbs would be basically the same. What would then be the meaning of the phrase from everlasting, I was woven? The best parallel would probably be Psalms 139:13b, where the psalmist states, you wove me in my mother's womb, using the verb sakak, denoting the process of gestation inside the mother. Interestingly, the parallel verb in that verse, Job 10:11, that would be in 139, the parallel verb is kana, for you formed my inward parts. You may remember kana is where they got Cain from. The two verbs express different ideas. Kana would designate the beginning, while sakak would refer to development of the embryo. In the case of wisdom in Proverbs 8, she is described as conceived or begotten by God. In verse 23, her development is described as a process of weaving together the different parts of the embryo. And finally, in verse 24 and 25, the moment of her birth is described. Her birth seems to coincide with the act of creation in the sense that at that moment, what was not yet was created. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he inscribed a circle in the face of the deep. When he made firm the skies. Throughout the whole process of creation, wisdom was with the Lord. She concludes by saying, then I was beside him as a master workman, and I was daily his delight. As the Lord is creating, wisdom is an object of his delight. It could very well be that the idea of delight is expressed in Genesis 1 through the use of the phrases, God saw that the light was good, God saw that it was good, and it was very good. God rejoices as he contemplates the works of his hands. The creation act is described in Proverbs 8, 31, and 32 as a cosmic playing activity, sahak, to laugh or play, indicating not only how joyful it was, but also how effortless the divine activity was. Both God and wisdom rejoice as the cosmos is coming into existence in a context free from conflict and filled with joy. This theology is also at the foundation of the theology of the creation in Genesis, where creation takes place free from conflict and as a result of the effortless power of God. On the surface, it could appear that the creation elements present in Proverbs 8, 22 through 31 seem to be quite different from what we find in Genesis, but this is not the that is not the case. A few concluding remarks may be useful to establish their theological congruence. First, the image provided by these texts is that of a God who effortlessly creates, assigns roles to the different elements, and establishes limits in order for everything to function in proper harmony. Second, the language of birth is exclusively associated with wisdom. Under the influence of ancient Near Eastern creation ideas, some have concluded in our passage, wisdom is a goddess. But what the text seems to indicate is that wisdom is a personification of a divine attribute. Third, as compared to Genesis, Proverbs 8 allows us to look back before the creation into the origin of wisdom. Here, wisdom originates from God's very self. In Genesis, we find a God who is fully active in creating, but here he is portrayed as a God who had been conceiving and weaving wisdom, creating it within himself. This wisdom later became the objective reality of the cosmos humans know and of which they are a part. The brief mention of the beginning of creation in Proverbs 8 has been more fully developed in Genesis 1 and 2. Fourth, the process of creation that we can detect in our passage is totally compatible with what we find in Genesis 1 and 2. In both cases, God is described as the architect or builder who separated things and assigned specific roles to them. It is true that creation through the divine word is not fully visible in Proverbs, but it is not totally absent. In the poem, the order of creation was established through the divine command, suggesting the presence of the spoken word. This is particularly the case in Proverbs 8:29, when he set for the sea its boundary, halt, so that the waters would not transgress, or abar, his command, pay. Interestingly, the pay actually literally means mouth. The word translated boundary could also be translated law or regulation. And here it would be designating the divine regulation governing the sea, which was not to be transgressed by it. Notice the personification of the sea, which fits with the poetic imagery and the poetic structure, for that matter, of Proverbs 8. The Hebrew word pe, translate command, means mouth, but by extension it expresses the idea of the spoken command, or what comes out of the mouth as a command. The specific command given to the waters is explicitly mentioned in Job 38:11a. Thus far you, speaking to the sea, shall come, but no farther. The phrase would not transgress his command means that the waters will not transgress what came out of the mouth of the Lord. We do have here a hint at creation through the spoken word. Summary: the creation theology found in Proverbs is related to the theology of creation recorded in Genesis 1 and 2. The creation of humans as male and female, united in marriage by the Lord. The references to the tree of life and the overall theology of creation in Psalms 8, 22 and 30, through 31 unquestionably demonstrated that the author of the book was acquainted with the creation narrative in Genesis. The wisdom poem provides, through the use of highly figurative or metaphorical language, some insights not present in Genesis, but compatible with it. It also expresses in poetic form ideas found in Genesis. The differences between the two enrich each other's depiction of divine creation. And his point is they're not contradictory, they're more complementary. Creation motifs in the book of Ecclesiastes. It is generally accepted that the book of Genesis has exerted some influence on Kohelet. For those who are wondering, Kohelet is the Hebrew title for the book of Ecclesiastes. Our primary interest is on the topic of creation, and in this particular case, there are just a few passages where this influence is clearly present, indicating that the author was acquainted with Genesis 1 to 3. One could begin with Hebel. One of the most frequently used verbs throughout the book, commonly translated vanity. It seems to contain an echo of the name of the second son of Adam and Eve, Abel, whose name actually is Hebel in Hebrew. I'm not sure an echo is the right word. It is precisely the same word. The noun designates that which is transitory and ephemeral, like Abel, who appeared for a brief period of time and then, like a vapor, was gone, and who may have gotten his name in the Genesis account posthumously. Kohelet universalizes the experience of Abel and describes all except God as vain, ephemeral, or empty of ultimate meaning. There's only one reference to God as creator, which may or may not be a reference to Genesis 1. Remember also your creator in chapter 12, verse 1. In the days of your youth, you may remember. The term translated creator is bore, the participial form of the verb bara, which most of you may remember is used in Genesis 1 fairly heavily, to create, which is occasionally used to designate the creator in other texts. If we look at the context of the passage, it could be argued that Kohelet had in mind Genesis. I think it's extremely arguable. This is suggested by the allusion to the nature of humans in Ecclesiastes 12:7. The dust, or afar, same word as in Genesis, will return to the earth, eretz, as it was, and the spirit, or ruach, which is slightly different, but is used as a synonym, will return to God who gave it. We are here within the conceptual world of the creation of Adam in Genesis 2:7, according to which God created him from the dust, or afar, of the ground, and gave him the breath of life, or the nishmat hayim. Kohelet is now using this ideology. I'm not sure I would use that word in that place because it has other contextual meanings, but he's now using this idea, I think, to describe what takes place when humans die. What belongs to God returns to him, and what was taken from the ground goes back to it. And there's a comparison with Genesis 3:19 as well. The idea that humans, literally Adam or Adam, were created from the dust and that they will return to it is also mentioned in Ecclesiastes 3:19 and 20. The context is a discussion of human mortality, and the conclusion is that from this perspective, humans are like the animals. They were both created from the dust, they both have the same breath, and when they die, they return to the dust. Genesis establishes that animals and humans were created from the ground, albeit in significantly different ways, and that they both are breathing creatures. This is the biblical background for arguing for what Kohelet, in his own peculiar way, is arguing. Kohelet establishes another connection with Genesis when he states, "Behold, I have found only this, that God made Asa, man, Adam, literally, upright, Yatsar, but they have sought out many devices." In his search, this is what Kohelet has found to be true, and it constitutes an important statement in the sense that humans are responsible for their own actions. This verse is an obvious reflection on the first few chapters of Genesis, though the vocabulary is in some cases different. But as you can see, Asa and Adam are straight out of Genesis 1 and 2. The verb Asa and the notion, the noun Adam are both used in Genesis 1:26 for the creation of humans. The use of Adam in both passages is generic. In agreement with the theology of Genesis, Kohelet indicates that originally humans were created upright or morally straight, Yatsar, but that they lost this uprightness through their own machinations. This theological reasoning is clearly based on Genesis 1 through 3. The creation of the world is alluded to at the beginning of the book in a poem that introduces the question of meaning. The poem is about the back and forth movements of all the basic elements of creation. And yet nothing really new happens, no advantage is gained, it all seems purposeless. The elements of the cosmos mentioned in the passage seem to follow the order in which they are recorded in Genesis 1. Ecclesiastes 1:3, the phrase under the sun is about light and sky and corresponds to the first and second days of the creation account. Well, yeah, if you stretch it a little. The reference to the earth corresponds to the third day in Ecclesiastes 1:4. Ecclesiastes 1:5 and 6, the statement that the sun rises and the sun sets is an allusion to the fourth day. Ecclesiastes 1:7, the movement of rivers in the sea could be correlated to creation of life in the water during the fifth day. And Ecclesiastes 1:8, humans can speak, see, and hear. This corresponds to the creation of humans on the sixth day. The order of creation in its organized movement is read by Kohelet as indicating the absence of the new. All, the totality of creation, has become in itself vain and purposeless. The term all, kol, is also used in Genesis 1 to designate the totality of creation. But it refers to a creation that, after coming from the hands of the Lord, was very good. According to Kohelet, creation is no longer what it was. Summary. Kohelet is indeed aware of the creation account, but he uses elements of that narrative to argue that creation by itself is vain and does not provide for humans' ultimate meaning. It is a dead end. That which has been is that which will be. There is nothing new under the sun. Those are, by the way, his ellipses. Human existence itself is ephemeral, and like that of the animals, will finally dissolve itself. But in accordance with the creation account, Koheleth recognizes that humans were originally created upright, and that the condition in which they find themselves now is the result of their own choosing. Conclusion: the three wisdom books that we have discussed, remember Job from last week, contain a number of references to the creation account recorded in Genesis 1 and 2. Arguments assume the reliability of the creation account and its significance in the lives of the writers and their audience. The references to the creation of humans, animals, and natural phenomena, and the earth, are found in these books are at times brief summaries, allusions, or even passing comments, but they are all compatible with what we find in Genesis. The experience of pain and suffering and even death is contrasted with creation and understood as a decreation experience. The original goodness is acknowledged, and the present fallen condition of humans is credited to themselves. The most penetrating contribution to the theology of creation is found in the personification of wisdom and its connection to creation. God's creation includes wisdom, which was created in the mystery of the divine being before it found expression with the objective phenomena of creation as we know it. Within that theology, creation through the word is assumed and even indicated in the text of Proverbs. This theology enriches the content of the creation narrative found in Genesis. The wise sages of the Old Testament were biblical creationists. Now, my take on all that, I largely agree with Rodriguez. I think one has to be careful not to overstretch in finding parallels. The parallel is a little shaky, for example, in the creation sequence. But I think the connections he finds are reasonable. Again, the account in Proverbs and Ecclesiastes cannot be used to prove that the Genesis account itself was normative, but they are consistent with it and suggestive of it. And I think that is a positive development. The personification of wisdom deserves more comment. Wisdom comes across as almost supernatural. Certainly, going forth from everlasting, the wisdom appears to be at least one model for the prologue of the Gospel of John. Remember, in the beginning was the Word. The connection appears even tighter when one realizes that the Greek logos did not just mean word, but could mean saying or even knowledge. Thus, our English derivatives, biology, geology, and so forth. The logos is the study of life, or the understanding of life, the knowledge. Objection could be made that the idea of a goddess besides God is foreign to the Old Testament, and certainly that is true. But if the metaphoric wisdom is metaphoric enough, it may be beyond the usual male-female distinctions. Remember, wisdom is female only because in Hebrew, wisdom is female. In that case, perhaps the gender is not an absolute roadblock to the proposed identification, that John was taking Proverbs to its logical conclusion. But that's my opinion, and now it's your turn. Yes, comment there.
You ended on that note about personification. I know Ellen White applies the wisdom statements in Proverbs to Christ. And I wish I had that reference with me. I could get it handily if I had my book. But
My comment wasn't specifically to exonerate or to support Ellen White, but... I think that the logic of the situation does kind of fit, and she's
definitely
simply recognizing that.
I'll add to that. At the very end, we tied wisdom in the Old Testament with logos in the New Testament. That's a pretty strong tie, I think. And especially as you look at it through the lens of Greek thought, Greek vocabulary and so on, and Jewish thought, philo. You know, Philo said a lot about wisdom, and he tied it in with logos. Now, I realize Philo wasn't a mainstream theologian of the early church. So you don't want to base too much just on Philo, but it shows that these ideas were very common in 1st, 2nd, 3rd century Christianity. And with that being the case, Christ being the Logos of John 1, Christ then is the wisdom of Proverbs 8.
I find it very interesting that the text has indications that wisdom was begotten at some point, and yet at the same time it has indications that she's been there forever.
That's right.
You know, raising all over again the Arian versus Trinitarian controversy. You know, did Jesus have a beginning, or was he there forever? And if Jesus is the begotten, was he begotten in universe time? Mm-hmm. And maybe that's part of the answer, is that when you're talking about, God's time is at least different from ours.
Maybe we can jump into a related topic. And for several weeks now, we've been looking at the idea, does the Bible support the idea of a very ancient universe and even a very ancient solar system and a very ancient world named planet Earth, at least the inorganic part. I think Proverbs goes a little different direction. What it's saying is, yes, there is something pre-existent beside God. You know, every Jewish author of the Old Testament would say that God is eternal. You know, they don't have a created God. That's polytheism. That's not Scripture.
And it goes all the way back to the Psalm of Moses, at least.
Exactly.
Where from... before the mountains were brought forth, before the hills existed.
Psalm 90, verse 2.
Everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
You are God. So that's important. But the question then that we have raised, you know, is there something here that's very, very ancient? You know, I think 12.5 billion years is pretty ancient. May seem like eternity for the whole universe. But... or it can be viewed as very young in light of God's eternity. What it's saying here, I think, in Proverbs is that wisdom is eternal. See? And so there is an entity that goes far beyond the confines of physical reality. And there's something that goes far in the direction of eternity. It doesn't use the word olam, I don't think, in Proverbs 8. It might.
It does.
It does, okay. And so that would tie in with the idea of eternity, something before the mountains, before the fountains, and so on. So it's a very lofty thought, but it kind of goes a different direction than our scientific thinking, that we want some kind of physical reality here prior to the 7 days. So those are my thoughts on that.
It does go in that direction. We had a comment over here, and okay.
It kind of reminds me of what we were talking about a couple of weeks ago about multiple meanings of a word, and I think that this word of the usage of the word wisdom again documents that multiple meanings of one word, and you'll have to look at the context as well to get an idea of which meaning they may be implying.
You know, it raises another interesting question, and that is that if wisdom is personified as female, that perhaps sometimes we take the foolish woman as a literal foolish woman. And I'm sure there are contexts in which that fits, but it raises the interesting question that that the foolish woman, a woman may stand for more than just simply a woman. And it's fascinating because, you know, there's one area in the early sections of Proverbs where Solomon talks about the foolish woman and in fairly literalistic terms, my husband is gone, he won't be back until the end of the month, and he took plenty of money to take him there, come, let's have our fill, my bed's all ready. That's pretty literal. But then there's another part where the foolish woman tells the young person who's being seduced that bread eaten in secret is pleasant. Stolen waters are sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. And it raises the question as to whether he has more in mind than simple seduction in that case. That there's this idea that if you get ahead more than what you deserve, that it feels good. And yet the ends thereof are the ways of death.
Yeah, the discussion has kind of moved along here, so I'm not quite sure where to jump in, but is there an objection? I suppose there is an objection, but what is the objection to identifying wisdom and logos with Christ? In other words, wisdom is there before creation. What was there before creation? Only God. And we know that God is one, but we also know he's three, and we can't explain that. But it seems to be rational and a very kind way by God to try and describe his multi-personality as wisdom and logos and the creator, and that's his son. I mean, we have no way of describing how he is his son. I have much easier to understand that the creator and Jesus was logos and wisdom than that he was a physical son. So what's the counter argument against that?
I think the major one, and it's alluded to in one of the notes that Rodriguez put out, is that this has been used to argue that there's a female consort to God.
Well, I think you explained that quite well. I mean, it's a Hebrew word, and just like in many other languages, certain words are female and male. That doesn't mean that they are female like a mother or male like a father.
Yeah, in English we don't have that in quite the same way.
But I mean, some languages, like my own language, Finnish, has no female and male pronouns. They're the same. We don't have, never had a need for a females to come up and have a riot and saying, hey, we want our rights, because the language itself makes us one. Now, in other languages, you have the differential and people get confused about it.
French being the famous one.
Of course.
But in just because in a given language, every noun has a gender, male, female, or neuter, does not imply that whatever is thus designated has some kind of actual gender. It is a linguistic device. It is not an actual conceptual form. Why in Yugoslavian, for example, would table be a male and the chair a female? In what sense would that make any sense? It's just a linguistic tool, that's all. And we should not ascribe to it more meaning than it deserves.
I agree with that, and I think that was the point I was raising, that once you reach certain level of abstraction, that male and female kind of loses its punch.
I like that word, upright. Thou hast created him upright, the animals not. Other than that, animals and men are same, but man was created upright. We could look at it as spiritually and physically also. Well, Lamarckism kind of loses its meaning when we consider, well, the grass was tall so he has to stand up, you know, so the predators don't get him. But thou hast created him standing up as well as upright in his heart.
I think that the primary meaning here in Hebrew is upright in the spiritual sense.
Right.
But I agree with you. I think there is a... there is a physical sense in which man was created upright, and that the spiritual meaning actually comes out of that in a sense. That, you know, people who are confident in what they're doing tend to stand up straight. People who are kind of tend to slouch down a little bit,
or should.
That's right. But if, you know, if they haven't totally corrupted themselves to where they don't even have a conscience, or at least it isn't operative, people who are used to being honest, usually when they start being dishonest, there is a change in the way they look, and some of it is loss of posture. It's interesting at this point also to bring in Beowulf, where there is the description of Grendel, who is a misshapen son of Cain. And the commentaries that are on there usually interpret this as whatever Grendel was, he actually walked in a more human way than in the typical four-footed animal way. Which raises some interesting questions as to what Grendel was.
The gentleman here correctly made the distinction between natural or physical gender and grammatical gender. However, as a footnote to that, I just happen to know, being married to a Thai lady, that in the Thai language there's 20 different words, at least 20 different words for you. And which word you use, and you better use the right one, depends upon who you are. So you don't say to the king, you, in the same way you say you to me or you, or even to a monk. Now, that being the case, I wonder whether in scripture we're talking about, and these things are culturally determined, all right? I mean,
yeah.
It's... you know, that's the context in which it's given. Now, when we're using scriptural language, our choice of our words when we're speaking about God may very well be informed by the fact that we want to glorify God and speak about Him in a way that's quite different from the way that we speak about other things or other people. What about that?
Yes. I think that wisdom has been a little bit of an embarrassment. You know, because if it's taken too literally, it sounds like there's a god and a goddess, which should be standard polytheism, but not traditional Hebrew monotheism. Of course, with Christianity, it's pretty easy for us to just simply take wisdom and convert it into logos, and convert it then into the second person of the Godhead and identify that with Jesus.
I wonder if sometimes we have this issue with Trinity. Now, I realize this is a new topic here, because we're confusing concepts. We consider ourselves as individuals, but we as individuals are not a single entity, because just the brain, we're told, has at least 100 billion neurons, not to count additional astrocytes and various other companion cells, all of whom serve a function. The body as a whole, we're told, is somewhere in the neighborhood of a trillion cells. not counting bacteria, who are 100 or 1,000-fold larger in number, all functioning as a symbiotic whole. So when I say me, who am I referring to? Which neuron in the brain is the one that holds that me? And when it talks about my, who is it that is being possessive? And how does the sentence my brain make any sense? Where is the I to whom the brain belongs? I mean, do you see the conundrum here?
But at the same time, we experience it as unity.
Yes, and that is the fascinating aspect of it. The problem we have with Trinity is because we want to dissect it.
This but part does this, and this part does
this.
Oh,
and this is such and such. But how did Christ pray? He prayed that they may be one as you and I are one. What does that tell us? We are in a state of disarray, discord, miscommunication, dysfunction. That is what he tries to repair, to restore. At which point we become more wholesome, more together, more in more understanding and appreciation of one another, to the point where everybody cares about everybody and takes them into account.
And the thing that's interesting is in Philippians here, Jesus said, is described as not considering equality with God a thing to be grasped.
It's like one neuron wanting to be the boss over another. In what sense does that make any sense? I mean, if one neuron were to seize control, we'd have a seizure. How's that an improvement?
Well done.
And we have a comment down here, too,
yeah.
When we get
to surely part of the solution to this beyond human capacity to grasp rests with the thing, how did God create? Whatever it is that the Hebrew scholars say he breathed into is not fully understood or described. But when we die, also something returns to God. So it is, in a sense, and this could be really bad heresy, in a sense, we only live because we are part of God. Now, it isn't the essential in heart of God. It's a fringe thing that we are, but we are still part of it, because once that thing which God gave Adam returns to him, we are just a bunch of dead cells and a billion, zillion, whatever else there might be in our bodies. That ceases to be a human.
Backing up a little bit, what you were talking about, functioning as one, it's very interesting that in the Bible, in I believe it's in Acts, where it talks about the disciples at the upper room after Christ had gone away, they had this period of spiritual revival of themselves, and it talks that they functioned as one when they then went out and had this fantastic period of giving out the information to the people around, and I believe it was something like, 3,000 baptisms in one day, and they were speaking in the tongues, and this group of 12 men were functioning as basically a single Christian revival entity.
As a matter of fact, it was 120 people, not just 12.
Also, getting back to wisdom, which we were discussing a while ago, when you go through the wisdom literature, it was interesting, there's different kinds of wisdom there. I mean, wisdom isn't just logos or Christ or whatever. It's also learning and knowledge. And it was interesting to me that after going all through Proverbs, I just finished these books just recently, going all through Proverbs, he's always talking about the importance of wisdom. It's the principal thing. And then in Ecclesiastes, right away in the first chapter, he says, I've dedicated my life to seeking after wisdom, and it's all vanity and vexation of spirit, which is something different than Christ.
Thank you very much, sister, but I feel pained. The reason why I feel pained here is because, please note, Solomon gained wisdom when he was approaching God with a desire to serve. And he was full of wisdom. He was gifted wisdom because he desired to serve. Once he turned the attention to trying and experiencing and, as he put it himself, taste everything, try everything, experience everything that can happen. What did he conclude? All is vain. Aha! There is something we ought to learn from this. Pursuit of selfish interest leads inexorably to emptiness, pointlessness, vanity. Why? Because it's a violation of love, which gives us fulfillment and meaning and purpose and direction. And as long as he loved God and his people, he had wisdom and all of the above. Let us not, therefore, put weight on his realization of the consequences of folly.
Well, there's one other thing, and that is interesting, that after he has gotten through all of this, how wisdom without...
What was the final conclusion?
The final conclusion, somebody can read it in the last two verses of Ecclesiastes.
Yes, please.
Well, that's a very good point. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil.
That doesn't sound like completely Hebel.
See, now that brings us to the real context of what's going on. The spiritual battle is the battle between madness and purpose, between nonsense and wisdom, between selfishness and love.
I would even go so far as to say that enlightened self-interest is an oxymoron. And that anybody who is sold on that, the devil has sold him a bill of goods. You know?
Are all the wisdom, the words for wisdom in the English, in the Hebrew, the same?
Well, obviously not exactly. I mean, there's a word that has been translated wisdom because it comes closer to wisdom than any other English word.
Well, I'm wondering if there are two glorious angels. One is Christ and the other is Lucifer. I mean, that's just an alternative example of it. In other words, you have wisdom which is actually foolishness, and you have wisdom which is the person of God and his character of love.
In that connection, if I may just add, sure. Now that I'm kind of hot under the collar. When I was 12, you know how in Sabbath school, we kids, we always hear about stories of all these great people. And of course, we've heard so many times the story about Solomon requesting wisdom, and it pleased God. So when I was 12, I thought, I'd kind of like to, being 12 is not exactly the best time of your life because everybody tells you what you're wrong at. So I thought, so I prayed, God, make me the wisest man on earth. Thank you. Amen. Mm-hmm. And opened an eye and waited for visual and sound effects, and none came. And I concluded it didn't work. Well, sometimes it didn't work. Lately, I was wondering how God must have thought when I prayed that prayer. Yeah, he was thinking, oh yes, I need another wise guy like a hole in my foot. You know what I'm saying? The point is not the wisdom, but the reason for the wisdom. Wisdom is a gift. You know, there is a verse in Revelation which says, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and glory and riches and wisdom. Why was he worthy? So I was thinking, why was Solomon worthy? Because he desired to serve his people. When he lost sight of that, that's when he ended up in vanity. As long as he kept close to that objective, that was what pleased God. Not the request for wisdom. Anybody wants to have stuff, or anybody might like to have the last word, as it were.
Humble.
Yes, he says, but I'm a child.
He could not manage without God. I think
exactly.
That's just as important.
Exactly.
His attitude.
That's right. You know, you would look at that, and I suddenly felt so embarrassed that I was so presumptuous. I mean, does that not put things in a different context all of a sudden?
I think it does.
Yeah, I think we've been discussing the analogy of wisdom. But I think also, when we look at it carefully, the root word before we reach wisdom is the fear of the Lord. So I would like to, if we can discuss more about the fear of the Lord, elaborate on that.
Well, next week we will be discussing the prophets. And if you have the books, you can see the comments that will be made. If you don't, I encourage you to look through some of the prophets and look at the creation themes that are there. I think they'll be informative. So we'll see you next week.